The title of this poem is Blind Pew. It was a visitor one Wednesday night. Aunt Rose and Cairo's little boy had gone to services at Sister Joe McShane's. She kept a storefront just across the street from Nolan Bainder's favorite saloon. And of a night, she'd hound the drunks to church before the services began. She'd shame them, too, until the meanest of the boys, one Mel Bo Turley then, was spirit caught and came near crawling to the altar, where he'd cry for Sister Joe and Jesus both to mend his suffering and raise his ma, who died while he was doing 18 months in Lincoln for assaulting Richard Byrd. Sister Joe'd have none of it. You won't blaspheme our Savior's house while I'm at home. Leave my name out, it's Jesus Christ can blind the wayward rambles of a sponge like you. Oh, Turley, a supplicant tonight, is it? Tomorrow you'll be blind and running loose 10 times at least as me and your mother's son. Would have stumbled on her broken knees to Kyle and back if sacrifice would keep you out of town and try and save your soul from Christ. She would have settled for sobriety before she died. Now I will too. The rest will have to run on luck. Then Bo, a washing candlelight in penitential tears, forswore grain alcohol and white port wine, forswore his pals, White River rats, forswore their ways, ungodliness and lion whores, in vain against Dawes County, and a hand no loving son should hold. He also vowed to shoot his dad, so Bowen Turley. Not long, Sister Joe would hear her fill. She had a plan that would keep him warm and out of danger's alleyway till early dawn, and she would wrap her arms around his chest and find some hands to help her drag him off inside a side room where she kept some flops for boys like Melvin and his river rats. And Carlos' little boy and my Aunt Rose were saving sinners then, just pitching in. They'd sing and ask for pity on the boys, including me and Grandpa, I suspect. When Bo was squared and soundless on his cot, his boots beside him on the floor, a quilt tucked snug against his chin, then Sister Joe would sign the cross invoked to Conchula and raise her eyes and, on occasion, cry. May I step in? I've got to have this boy to bed. He'll work a book or two, then he's got to roll. I understand. I won't take too much of your time. And what you give, he will repay 10,000-fold. The boy will benefit the most. You'll see in ways uncountable. I guess you're in, so what? Is that a testament you're carrying? Aunt Rose has memorized it through by heart. Not maybe all, but most. Aunt Rose. She's off to church at Sister Joe McShane's with Carlos. They pray to God and sing. They're pitching in. Are you traditionals? I can't help noticing a feather and what looks like sage above the crucifix just there against the wall. What do you want? You want a contribution to your church? Aunt Rose and Sister Joe are coffee sharks. Come back when they're both here. And Carlos, too. They like to spend most of an afternoon just swelling coffee and discussing God with preachers who are out collecting dough and saving souls. Then they might come again. Our souls are in such jeopardy. Our hearts are perishing for sacramental blood. His perfect love, our prayers, our offerings. Then come again when Sister Joe is here and Carlos' little boy. Aunt Rose will make fried bread. She'll brew some coffee, bake a pie. They love to listen while a preacher sets the world right. The man, reluctantly, I thought, from where I sat over my book, Blind Pew, fomenting mischief, and a boy like me grown anxious that a derelict and unattending world was drowsing, though adventure's call, then turned to go. He'd hoped to say another word, but Grandpa closed the door and sighed, then nodded me to bed. Years later, after everyone was dead, I read a story in the Journal Star about how Sister Jo, then 84, had been murdered while she prayed alone one night. Her niece discovered her. She lay upon her back, her Bible tucked beneath her head. The shawl Aunt Rose had made for her too tight around her throat and covering her face so that you couldn't tell if she'd seen Beau approaching slowly or recalled him clear. Now, this woman, whose name I changed, had a storefront right across from Dub Miller's favorite saloon. And she would call the boys out of the night and get them praying right up in the front row, right here in Chapman. Aunt Rose is always in great demand. If ever I would write about my aunt, I'd have to mention her Lakota hymns and how the mourners from as far away as Kyle and Porcupine sent down for her when we moved down to Shadron Labor Day in 1953. From Manderson they sent, from Mission and from Wounded Bay, from Fast Horse Creek and Ogallala too. From Red Shirt Table, mourners sent for her, and from Pine Ridge, sometimes Potato Creek. Slim Utes held out, though, for a couple of years because, as Grandpa said, they kept a grudge from when Aunt Rose's father's cows got clear and caused an accident 3 miles this side of Johnny Weasel Bear's. A little boy was hurt and later died. Aunt Rose's father tried to make things right, but everyone took sides and things were said. Then someone dumped a cow into the river north of Felix Frogs and covered it with willow brush and logs. And when it started rotting in the spring, a stink washed through the whole White River south of Frogs. And it would taste that stink. And when the little spotted horses found the hide, it bore the Connor's lonesome jay. The law convened, but couldn't find. Then Carlos here heard Elvie Thompson's boy one night in town, back at the Fayrock, big mouthing with a pint of ancient age. After a few, he'd bragged they'd turned the circus loose, his dad and him, and that they meant when Rose's dad was in the pen to grab his land, his stock, rock bottom, and his new windrow, too. But when Carlos told his Uncle Dan, he knocked him down and tied him to a tree. That's all Grandpa would say. But during weeks and months and years of bits and pieces there, I learned Aunt Rose's father drove to town and found those two while they were drinking beer at Buddy's bar and shot them dead. Their heirs still got the land, though, and Dan Connor tried to break the pen of Lincoln and was crucified with 12 more years. Aunt Rose's mother was a kills at night, and when she had to sell their land to pay the bank and all too soon the funeral expenses, she began to wander out along the Slim Buttes Road and throw whatever came to hand at passing cars. "You have no relative," she'd scream and sue, or in what French she knew. The day she died, Aunt Rose and Carlos rode to their stretch to coax her, drag if necessary, off the road. The wind was up that latter end of day in mid-July, and dust as sharp as glass caught in their eyes, so that they couldn't see her when she stepped into a load of yearling steers. It wasn't just Aunt Rose's voice. She sang old style and often made my grandpa cry, but only when she sang around the house. The elders wouldn't cry at funerals unless it pained inside too much to hold their grief. And all they needed was Aunt Rose, her voice, her old-time way of cradling their pain and rocking it to sleep. Another day, she'd sing old-timey gospel music too. And Carol's little boy and I would beg her after dinner and the giveaway to sing. It's the same Maybelle Carter, then some Hank, and so she'd give us Wildwood Flower, and then I Saw the Light. And then, approaching day, on our way home along the Slewfields Road, one of her favorites, Hank's Lost Highway. We'll do one more. Been working on this one. These are all narrative poems. Maybe we'll do two more. I like Aunt Rose's rummaging. This is called Buried Deep at White Horse Creek. One night I asked Grandfather if we might explore the ground just south of Porcupine for arrowheads. The Boy Scouts went up there and found a bunch, I said. Boy Scouts? Where? He asked. From middle school, the Boy Scouts, Gramps. They're on the go. They hike and camp around. They do their crafts. Their crafts, is it? He said. Who's heading up the craft department now? The science teacher, Mr. Norris, Gramps. Mr. Norris is the leader. He had them south of Porcupine, they said, last April and again this coming May. I hope they don't get poked, Grandfather said. But maybe Carlos has a relative up there, can keep them clear of diamondbacks and bed the scouts down nice and lazy where they'll find a decent sleep. But Carlos heard. Just coming in from Goodman's Produce, where he'd gone for bleach and suds, we've got to do a day to do the wash and hang and fold, he said, against Aunt Rose's return. And she'll inveigh against the shore if we slack off. You both have got more relatives up there than me. I won't abide a rusty bolt to shut me in. I say it's backstabbers and worse up there. It's arrowheads this time, Grandfather said. Boy Scouts are on the trail. Don't sell the science teacher short. Don't turn all sour against your blood. Although he smiled, although there was no anger in his voice, there was an edge. And Carlos turned his eyes to Grandfather's and held them there for what seemed overlong. It took some time before I came to reckon what I wasn't told, until my reckoning exceeded what I was. There's blood to go around, he said. There's not an arrowhead or bone you'll find that won't be bloody, broke, or ripped apart. I say to let him be. I looked at my grandfather, then to Carlos' little boy, and felt between them something hanging, like the echo of a wounded hawk, the sound the wind made up at Fast Horse Creek the day they buried Carlos' sister Pearl when I was only 4 years old and bundled in a quilt then set within a little grove of frozen waist-high grass that stood between the burying and me. Her son Sylvester drove each nail into the cedar boards, each ring of steel on steel exploding down the creek like single shots or lone and single barks of grievous wounded dog will make before all hope is gone and death is nigh. And when the keening caught the air, the wind began to slice down from the ridge and make its moan and naked voice among the rest. And I was cold that time, despite Aunt Rose's voice, which caught the wind and shook it like she would a musty shawl. And when I think of it, though deep in August in the thunder moon, when we would damp the ground beneath our quilts and sleep out back, when breathing was a chore inside the house, no matter where I am, no matter now, though 4 years are gone since I sat lorn and chilled and terrified, surrounded by sharp stands of frozen grass. Sylvester's pounding and his mother gone. Each nail exploding in the cedar planks, exploding down the twisting, barren length of Fast Horse Creek, and in the quaking heart of me. And with the keening and the wind, relentless wave on wave, and me in mute debilitation while my relatives exulted in the futile massacre of everything that lives, I say a chill strikes deep within me like a piece of steel against a lethal edge of flint. And in that sound, in each reverberation, gaunt, quick, sharp, and clean, my blood congeals in sadness in the fathomless night chambers of that time. Aunt Rose would not allow a bitterness to breed. The time for tears is short, she'd say. Blind Angus threads his needles by himself and beads without a light. Those arrowheads will have to burrow deeper in the bank, Grandfather said, or else those scouts will catch the lot and mount them on the nearest wall. The nearest wall's a further stretch up north, said Carlos. They sell pills and crafts. And when you come on time, you get free coffee. With this, the kitchen air began to clear, like any sky would of an afternoon when storm clouds threatening disperse, or like a bitter soul enraptured in a long, unreckoned bliss. At least I hope they ask permission first, those scouts, said Carlos then. Who from? I asked. But he turned away and disappeared into the basement where we heard him rummaging with this and that. My grandfather was smiling, my eyes betraying vexation. Caught him struggling to keep his mouth from fracturing in mirth. Then Carlos' feet were heavy on the stairs. He held the laundry basket and he huffed. Let's make some suds and hang alone before the afternoon plays out. Just sitting here, we're tempting wrath, and I know who will win. And that's it. Thank you very much. It's like hand grenades in my ear.